The Stoa is a digital campfire where we cohere in dialogue about what matters most at the knife's edge of what's happening now.
All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Stoa, a digital campfire where we cohere and dialogue about what matters most at the knife's edge of this very moment. And today we have Daniel Görtz back in the house to talk about metamodern sexuality, I believe, is the topic for today. We'll go on a deep dive and see what comes of it. So if y'all are ready, let's go for it. Hey, Daniel, welcome.
Hey, good to be back. And today I have roses for the occasion. So let's see. I just switched between one computer and the other, and the presentation is still loading. Let me download it, and I can start already. Actually, so we're not actually going to talk only about sex or sexuality. We're going to craft a metamodern theory of gender, and one of the big blind spots, generally speaking, when people talk about, well, people talk about these things as different topics. You have sexuality and sex. You have relationships and the dynamics of relationships. And that's a topic in itself, a couples therapy and so on. And then you have gender theory, of course, and the different schools within that. And then you have on a more societal or sociological level, the reproduction of society or the family formation complex. So if you put these three together, you have the gender, sexuality, family formation complex. And all of these things intersect so intimately that it makes sense to discuss them together, or else your perspective is going to have major blind spots. So let's see if PowerPoint wants to allow this. Enable editing. There you go. And slideshow from the beginning, and now I can share my screen with you guys. Yes, I admit people as well, right? See the waiting room, admit, welcome Peter.
Daniel, you are mute.
Good grief. I've been talking all this time on mute.
Just for like 5 seconds.
I was just asking, should I be admitting people as well?
No, Laura will be doing that.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. So share screen. Let's see if this works. There we go. Is this any better? And the slideshow from the beginning. So what we have here is a metamodern gender theory, the gender sexuality family formation complex. So let's take it from the beginning. First, we talked about aesthetics and the arts. Then we delved into spirituality. And there's a bridge, I suppose, in the spiritual realm to the sexual one, and to the formation of sexual identity and these relationships, that the romantic relationships that we have in our lives. So when we talked about a metamodern view of spirituality, we started from phenomenology, from the fact that we always have a kind of an ocean of experience, and that we can notice more, we can delve more or less deeply into it. And the deeper we go, the more fundamental parts of our reality we're dealing with, and the more intimate parts we're dealing with, then the interest, and we also particularly zoomed in on the concept of cosmoeroticism, meaning that we're in love with life, that something makes us feel alive. And this aliveness is always either there or not there. So a goal of society can and should be, and it's a reasonable goal, to try to engender, to generate this cosmoeroticism as an experience of all people in society. And sexuality then, lust or eroticism or drive, is inescapably linked to our participant experience in reality. And this goes back, of course, to Freud, who argues that that you can look at an oral face of little kids when, first of all, you focus on what you can taste with your mouth, and then it goes on from there. But there is a fundamental drive that permeates all of experience. And this drive is playful and sexual and has a sexual aspect to it and an erotic aspect to it. So when we talk about sexuality, we shouldn't confine ourselves to the tip of the iceberg, which is the actual sex happening in the world and the actual sexual practices and actions of real people. If we add all sexual innuendos, all sexually charged dreams, all fantasies, or all sexual emotions that show up when we pass just strangers on the street or whatever, we notice this is a huge part of reality as we experience it. Now, this has tempted a lot of people to be Freudians and to be sexuality reductionists, but the fact that something is a dimension of reality, that's the fact that something permeates all of it, doesn't mean that all of the rest can be reduced to it, not at all. But it's definitely there. And all the time, we're not neutral to what we observe. When we observe, we also participate. We never participate neutrally. And this, by the way, this wasn't even part of the plan of what I was going to talk about, but I can't help myself from bringing it up. I read this one last year. This is the Swedish edition of Beauty Evolution, or the Evolution of Beauty is this, the term is the title in English by Richard O. Prom. He's a feminist inclined biologist, and he argues that this isn't just the case in human beings, that aesthetic concern, the lust or drive or wanting for beauty is inherent across the animal kingdom, and as such it sparks all of these beautiful feathers and stuff and all of these dances in evolution, so that even crude things like the evolutions of species, which we have been taught to think of in Darwinian terms looking for fitness or assessing each other for functional qualities, these are take on a life of their own, and they detach themselves entirely from functionality, which is, by the way, the same thing that happens when human beings get rich. Behind me are embellishments of my home because I had excess resources. There are roses here because it was my girlfriend's birthday today, or it is my girlfriend's birthday today. So again and again, we are always engaged in life in this larger phantasmic realm. If you if you take all of the unconscious drives as well, but all of the innuendos, you cannot escape this dimension. And for this reason, it belongs at the heart of any serious utopian or relative utopian or protopian political project. You're just not dealing with the real reality and with the real transformations of human beings and society, unless you're dealing with the ubiquity of sexuality. And then, of course, when anthropologists go to a foreign tribe, the first thing they're going to look at is, okay, how do these people get food? And how do they reproduce? So it is the fundamental aspect also, together with food and shelter, it is the fundamental aspect of how society is structured. So society is going to be structured around a certain reproductive regime. So that's something about the ubiquity of this topic. Just as spirituality is inescapable and aesthetics is inescapable, sexuality is, and these are intertwined. And that is the cosmoerotic drive in us and our societies. And because of this, there is an inherent tragedy to existence here. Because all of these claims, all of these assessments of experience, is this pleasurable? Do I want this? Do I want to approach this or do I want to distance myself from it? They drive evolution. So there's always both the observer, like this is a male bird, their evolution has co-evolved with the aesthetic sexual drive of the females of its own species. And whenever we have a sexual experience or drive, we're making a claim, a kind of power claim in a sense, that, well, I want to fuck you. Well, you can always say no, right? You should be able to say in a way, either way, or I want to kiss you, I want to approach you, so anything like that. You always, there's always a claim that here is something for me. I'm making a claim on reality. I'm showing up. I want something. So is this a zero sum game? Well, if I want a certain woman, another person can't have her. Well, it's not necessarily. But the point is, we cannot remove all zero sumness from it. So it's a non-zero sum game rather than a zero sum game. Love is a non-zero sum game. So sure, you can love both your kids, but you can't love a million kids as much. So sooner or later, there is actually some kind of trade-off. And because of this, it's linked to the most vulnerable parts of us at the same time as we're necessarily making claims that can be rejected. For this reason, we're all going to get hurt by love and by sexuality and by these drives within ourselves. So sexuality is ubiquitous and it is inherently tragic. It is linked to the higher states and to the lower states. We'll get back to that. There are a few different key ways to relate to the tragedy, inherent tragedy of the sexuality, gender, family formation complex. And you might recognize these from the Hanzi books. And that you can either deny that there is a game and say, well, just be nice, and it doesn't have to be that what one wins, another loses, etc. And for a while, that can work out. But when you're denying the game, you're also never able to fully address it. And there are aspects, for instance, that women like strong men rather than weak men. And if you deny this aspect, and you, when you bring up boys, for instance, they're likely to, the men are going to likely be quite confused by what they find and embittered perhaps. We'll get back to that. Or you can go to the other side and say game acceptance. You can say, well, love is a game, and love and war, all things are allowed, are permitted. And you can say, and you can read Neil Strauss' The Game, and you can think about all the crude mechanics of power and seduction, and you can try to master the game and say, hey, may the best player win, and whoever gets the short end of the stick kind of deserved it. And today these are, in a way, the dominant forms of relating to sexuality. So either that just be nice and be a good feminist and everything is gonna be okay for the men, for instance, or you don't have to live up to all of these femininity ideals for women and so on. But then people get, life bites them back when you're terribly disappointed. And then some people bitterly go over to game acceptance and they say, okay, screw that. I'm not gonna lie to myself. I'm not gonna lie to other people. I'm just gonna play the game. I'm gonna make it, and I'm gonna learn its rules, even if they're crude sometimes, and find my way forward. Now, with game acceptance, you're also kind of accepting the inherent tragedy of the current games of love and romantic love and sexuality and gender relations. So then you're not questioning whether or not women are treated fairly and so on. And it doesn't really allow for that kind of question. So it doesn't allow for critical reappraisal. Now, if you combine these two, I would say unproductive stances, their bastard child is actually a much better one. You accept that life is a game, and sexuality and love is a game, and there are certain dynamics you have to understand, but you deny the injustices, or you deny that they would be acceptable. You say that, I'm not gonna accept we're not gonna accept the cruelties, the unnecessary cruelties and limitations, inherent tragedies and limitations of the current, of the game in its current form. So we're gonna try to transform the game of love. We're going to try to make it fair, transparent. We're gonna try to make more people be able to learn this game of love better. We're going to try to make more people be able to play it better, and we're going to try to make it much more inclusive and create much more second chances. So sometimes when people talk about this, a good sex life isn't a right, they will say what they particularly mean often is that men shouldn't feel entitled to the bodies of women, and that's of course correct. If you look at it in as a human right, that in a narrow sense. If you broaden the sense of a human right to a positive human right in the sense of education, for instance, education is a human right, or something like that, it makes a lot more sense that we can, it should be a primary goal of society to create positive gender relations and cosmoerotic expressions of relationship and relationality in everyone's life. And that's a right we can and should defend. And the games that exist that are not fair and conducive towards that end can and should be reformed, not unrealistically, but according to their inherent limitations. So let's start going through a couple of different stances here. Feminism is important. feminism brings up the structural injustices between men and women. As you know, there's of course classical bourgeois feminism like Wollstonecraft's, and going back to the end of the 1700s, a vote for women and all of these things that grew in the 1800s and blossomed at the beginning of the 20th century. And it basically says something along the lines that, wait a minute, these laws are unfair. Women are being discriminated against. They should be able to enter the job market if they so wish. And then you have a second, I mean, people have divided this up in many more steps, but you can roughly divide it up following the meta memes and the value memes that we have discussed earlier. You can divide it up into a second awakening, a kind of postmodern feminism, where the postmodern feminism looks at, okay, so once you have a nominally legal equal society, you still have all of these structural injustices that women do all the work at home or a lot more of it anyway. They are less remunerated for that work as well as for other work. In the job market, you have that if men in de facto control a very, very large part of the financial resources, they are going to have power over the bodies and lives of women. And on it goes. And the women can't walk down the street without being catcalled, or you're judged very, very much by your appearance. And what postmodern feminism was, or still is a kind of awakening to these intimate, unconscious shackles that are holding you. You notice that you've been in a straitjacket. You notice that you've been brainwashed by Barbie dolls, and you rebel against it and you throw it off. You begin using much more oblique or indirect methods of achieving gender justice. Justice for your gender not reduced to your gender, to show up as a human being, not just on paper, but implicitly and in your real experience of life and all the implicit little social games that you're nevertheless subject to, right? So, yeah. These are important positions. You noticed I didn't put up metamodern feminism. We'll get back to that. Now, as of late, we have seen the rise of masculism in different shapes and forms. And this is where things get really interesting for the future, I think. So by and large, well, if you ask me, I think that feminism is correct, that there is no reason to believe that structural injustices don't exist between the genders, and that a lot of people suffer a lot for it in many, many ways. If you look at the masculinist movements, though, you could parse out three different strands, really. Two of them are fairly regressive and reactionary. So you have traditionalist masculism, which says, okay, feminism is bullshit. We need to stop bitching about all of this stuff. And we need to reassert family values, which have clear gender roles, and that those weren't so bad, and maybe we've made a mistake. And they can have partial truths in that, of course. Basically, that you should go all the way back to the pre-modern gender roles, and maybe not retracting on stuff like women's suffrage. Even the Nazis envisioned that women could vote, but they did see women in a particularly traditionalist manner and particularly had an ideal of the housewife as the model of a woman. And these things aren't always entirely delineated from each other. Or you can have, you just want to retract on the postmodern feminism that men should stand up for their rights and men should not accept all the postmodern feminism, not all the gender theory stuff, all the Judith Butler stuff, all the questioning, the scale of gender stuff, reasserting that there are biological differences, and then be happy with bourgeois modern feminism, which says we have equal rights, we are equals, and now let that be that. And I guess you can see that this one goes fairly strong in for instance, the ideological dark web. And I would argue that they accept Wollstonecraft's critique of clear injustices between the genders, but they don't accept what grew with Simone de Beauvoir and then flowered in the 60s and then took over our universities beginning from the 90s as postmodern feminism. But both of these strands are fairly regressive. What they are pointing out correctly, however, and which is also an element of the third kind of masculism here, which I want to call reconstructive, is that feminism was created by women, for women. So they're naturally these theorists, and these theories are naturally not very good at taking male perspectives or the perspectives of men. So even, and the argument from feminists would likely be often that, wait a minute, the perspectives of men is what dominates society to begin with, is already the a priori perspectives of society at large and mainstream our mainstream culture. Now, But if you look at that a bit closer, you see that no, mainstream culture does not have an emancipatory discussion about what it is to be a man and all the nasty dynamics men are stuck in. So they're leaving out half of the equation. And you're never going to emancipate the genders, any of the genders, if you don't take both sides of the equation into account. And who are best at taking male perspectives and who have grown up with the vulnerabilities and mind fucks and contradictions of men? Well, only men have. So that's why masculism is needed as a response to feminism, but as a post-feminist response, one that accepts the first wave of feminism, the second wave of feminism, of course, critiques it when it's not accurate or whatever, or misconstrues how men experience the world, but adds the perspective of men. And this does not then mean a retraction of masculinity, because that's not what we experience in life. We're not rewarded by women by not affirming our masculinity. We are rewarded sexually and emotionally and career-wise when we show at least some masculine qualities and capabilities. So the reconstructed masculinity does not say, okay, we need a new kind of man, a feminist man. It says, yes, we should accept feminism. We should accept that there are facts of the world, structural facts of the world, about the structural inequalities, particularly if you look globally between the genders, and then we should reconstruct them, including reconstructing a masculinity, which doesn't just say that we're going to be nice, we're going to be feminists and so on, we're going to actually be positively masculine. At the same time, of course, barring all the methodologies from particularly postmodern feminism, looking at statistics, implicit power structures, implicit norms on that govern your behavior and set the limits for how what you're rewarded for and punished for, and use all of that to emancipate men, which isn't the same as emancipating women. So that's kind of, I think, the kind of masculism that would align with a metamodern take on gender. Now, both feminism and masculism are mixed bags. So there are life-affirming elements in both of these, but they are intimately entangled with bitterness. And this bitterness, of course, comes from all the traumas that you have suffered throughout your life and all the things that have been confusing and that didn't seem to ring true and that seemed to put you in nasty double binds and all the rest of it. But when, you can have this bitterness for good reasons, but when it grows into gender antagonism, meaning a generalized bitterness against a whole gender or a whole sex, then it poisons the emancipatory or self-assertive potential of your movement. So feminism, unfortunately, is shot through with gender antagonism against men. And you don't have to look very far. You know, you go to a feminist meeting and people will be angry at men in general, which makes the whole movement quite unappealing to men, and it makes it quite poor at taking male perspectives. You go to a masculist gathering, or they gather on the web, of course, and you have the whole scale, like, so you can go from incels, if you go on that, the incel site, I wouldn't recommend it. I went in there once to just stroll around, and it's horrifying. It's kind of like the Nazism of gender or something. They really, 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 really hate women, and they think they're revealing the big lies or feminist lies of our culture. And it's absolutely paranoid. It looks like a big, huge conspiracy theory. You can go from there to men's rights activists who have much more good arguments on their side, but there's still an element of being angry at women. And I think looking at Jordan Peterson and stuff and Camille Paglia, there's that element still. But emancipation is kind of the promise of feminism. But feminism at the same time demasculates, castrates men a little bit. So men have to, after feminism, in the post-feminist moment, reassert themselves somehow. Also for the sake of sexuality and for the sake of polarity and for the sake of women and families. So the masculist movement has a self-assertive project that, okay, if I swallow all that pride and I give away all that power and I equalize all of these things, how can I still assert myself? as a strong masculine presence in your life and in my own life. But when that comes with gender antagonism, oftentimes with a wholesale rejection of feminism, then things get quite venomous. And of course, the project is going to fail or at least fail in its self-assertive potential, because you will frustrate the other gender a lot. Not necessarily the gender, but people on the other political side, because there are both men and women on both sides. We really do live in gendered times. That's very important to notice. It's not just the ubiquity of sexuality that is a thing. It's also that in this historical moment, 500 years ago, we had the religion wars, and religion was kind of at the pinnacle, or like at the very crux of Western civilization. And we had to figure out, like, wait a minute, like, should we buy these forgiveness letters from the Pope and all of these things? And people had to fight it out, you know? And they had to figure out a new equilibrium. And eventually they decided, well, let's not kill each other over religion. 150 years ago, up to 50 years ago, we had a period that had to do with race and ethnicity. And that was at the very crux of Western civilization, and I suppose in many ways of the world system itself. And we went through a large embodied reassessment of all of our preconceptions on that matter. And we got even more intimate, because it had to do with things like skin color, with like our bodies and stuff. And now we're kind of in the gender times, where gender has become the key turning point around which all other things, political things particularly, and culture wars revolve. And just look at Sweden, for instance. How do people vote? So you look at the women, and you have a vast majority voting for the parties to the left and the Greens. You look at the men, you have the opposite. You have so many men. It's the largest party among men, the Nationalist Party, which is anti-feminist. So the culture wars have gotten particularly pernicious, because they have to do with this deep vulnerability, this tragedy of existence that we talked about. And now it's landing in everybody's body, and the culture wars and the wars of politics are playing out around this crux in many, many ways. So yeah, they're both mixed bags. And of course we want more of the positive elements. We want more of the emancipatory potentials of feminism, and we want more of the self-assertive elements of masculinism, and we want less of gender antagonism. So the goal becomes to reduce gender antagonism in society. We don't want a society where the average person walks down the street and is angry at the opposite gender, or their own gender for that matter. Like I said, I use these terms a little bit sloppily now, talking about two genders. But zooming in on that a little bit, so full spectrum gender. The metamodern movement is not feminist nor masculist. It is both and. It is both post-feminist and neo-masculist. So a new masculinity in harmony with radical feminism. And if it cannot cope with radical feminism, and it cannot coordinate with that, it doesn't fit the bill, and we have to keep experimenting with our masculinity until it does, because we can't stand behind huge structural injustices, and there's no hiding the cat back in the bag, or maybe there might be if we have fascist regressions and so on. So anyway, emancipate the entire spectrum and the entire spectrum between the genders, that is. We increase experimentation and degrees of freedom, and we increase the acceptance of the whole spectrum. I'll actually read aloud a little thing here from post-feminism in Nordic ideology. Post-feminism. Basically, the post-feminist position is one that accepts the queer feminist idea that gender roles change with historical circumstances and culture, and that ideas about genders and their interactions can and should continuously be critically reconstructed to optimize for new circumstances, but doesn't buy the feminist idea that there is one toxic mainstream ideal of masculinity, which is pitted against the feminine underdog. And that if patriarchy is crushed, then people will become free from gender roles and their oppression. Rather, we want to develop both sides, not crush the patriarchy. And then there would be a state of nature in which people are already free. That's a Rousseauian term, Rousseauian way of thinking that still imbues the left to our day. Anyway, post-feminism gets its name by transcending and including feminism. Once we have accepted the basic feminist tenets, then what? What comes after? Post-feminism is a both-and position, both feminism and masculism. Both women's issues, sexual harassment, lower wages, lesser political power, pressures to conform to body ideals, slut shaming, etc. And men's issues, expendability, having dangerous jobs, easily being considered losers when asking for help, homelessness, higher suicide rates, crime and incarceration, more physical violence, etc. Both anti-discrimination of sexual minorities and the facilitation of positive heterosexual relations and secure attachment patterns for family relations, including then the conservative elements, both teaching men how to become more successful at dating and picking up sexual partners and to respect sexual boundaries and not sexually objectify women. Both defending the right to be a hipster beta male and to be a tough masculine guy. Both a butch and a pink girly girl. Both solidarity with the jaw-dropping babes and with the chronically unfuckable. And that's very important. That if our solidarity doesn't stretch to the losers of the sexual games, then we don't have a real solidarity movement. One moment, I realize I look like a ghost here. There is a scale from classically masculine to feminine values, demeanors, and behaviors. Post-feminism defends the whole scale. The right for people to move freely and explore across all of it. It doesn't defend the androgynous at the expense of sexual polarities or vice versa. It defends all points of the scale, the entire richness of human gender and sexual expression. This means some people will settle for traditional gender roles while others will be queer shapeshifters. All should be defended. So that tries to set just a sentiment for what we want this kind of postmodern gender, or I'm sorry, metamodern gender to do, gender theory to do. We want, well, knowing that there is intersexuality, for instance, knowing that there are many ways in which you can biologically not be of either gender, knowing that people may have a very strong psychological or identity reasons for wanting to change their genders, knowing that they might want to change back, knowing that people might not understand any of this and just want to be within conventional gender roles. The point is that we don't have a truly solidary and emancipatory and self-assertive movement, a movement that helps people to self-assert, unless all of those positions are viewed as okay and as something that can and should be defended politically and culturally and in everyday interactions. So what happens with David Data? What happens with tantric polarity, which is so exciting and such a great source of pleasure and comfort in so many people's lives and meaning? So the truth is, polarity just means something interesting happens between poles that are different and attracted to each other because of this difference. There's nothing to say that there are only two poles or two set points in this polarity. Well, for instance, we have, among lesbians, we have butches, and that's a kind of another set point of polarity where one is the masculine part and the other is the feminine part. But they're both women, for instance, and on it goes, really. Androgynous people who don't have very, very strong, who aren't hyper-masculine, tend to be attracted to a bit less hyper-feminine women and so on, or at least settle down in relationships with them and the other way around. So what we want is a rich polarity so that people can try out many different set points and still recreate that polarity in their lives. And sometimes triangle dramas and so on can be just as exciting and have even greater polarity. So there's no exact formula here. There are formulas. It's not a free-for-all. If you just try to apply no rules and no polarity and no norms at all, then people just get super confused and the polarities do in fact break down. But the fact that you can move across a wider spectrum of gender doesn't in itself mean that polarity flies out the window and you can't read up on your David Data and ravager and all of those things that are in there. If that's where your inclinations get you, the point is that people should know about a wider range and that the landscapes of desire themselves can and should be developed, meaning that if we develop into more secure attachment patterns, into a richer experience of life, we're also able to see multiple hierarchies, multiple dimensions, and create richer polarities across more dimensions. And the likelihood then that people enter into mutually reinforcing relations with each other for short or long periods, and which are not confusing or detrimental to us, increases. Yes, of course, family formation follows the same. So just as we're not looking to get rid of polarity, we're looking to enrich it and deepen it through more own experience. The same goes for family formation. We have wider experimentation, wider, not wilder. That can be a part of it too. I meant to write the collective experience builds new institutions. That if we do have greater greater capacities on both sides and less on all sides, I should say, greater sexual and emotional and relational capacities and perspective taking on all sides, then we can experiment more and we can together find new norms for different forms of family formation. So we have all forms, all kinds of star families. We have now polyamorous relationships popping up more and more. We have relational anarchy. We have a lot of different kinds of family formations. So, and of course, non-heterosexual families and families where you just, where you're not romantically together, but you still bear kids together. There are many, many more alternatives, but because we're in between worlds and we're breaking up one order, which feels constraining to many, and we haven't yet reached the other shore where we know a set of different institutions, we tend to be very confused and very disappointed and very hurt. And this breeds new trauma, and it breeds then new gender antagonism, which then breeds this vicious circle. But what we want is still a good family, meaning that people attach and build strong relationships, which are good for instance, child rearing and all the rest of it. We're not throwing that out, we're enriching that. That's important. And that's not the enemy of gender liberation. It can be in certain ways, or the liberation of the spectrum. But ultimately, these two things have to be married. So, I mentioned love and sex and romantic attachment as a transformational practice, and that it has to do with capacities and capabilities. Now, I want to underscore this point because if we look at developmental psychology and stages of adult development, there's just, and this goes back in a way to a sociologist, Italian sociologist Alberoni, who wrote about romantic love and friendship and many other things. And he wasn't a developmental psychologist or anything like that. But he had the idea that when we fall in love, we're usually in one stage of life and we want to get to another one. So we're likely to fall in love with someone or something, but someone usually, because someone and something, because we're all cyborgs, we're all part of a larger setting of cultural symbols and the societies around us. So we don't just fall in love with a person, we fall in love with the elements of that person which we want in our lives and we feel is in our own potential to transform too. So for this reason, and when you generally want to transform into things that you kind of sense you have the capacity to become, but you're not yet capable of. So we've already said that, well, it links to spirituality because falling in love, of course, links to cosmic eroticism, to the highest states of the phenomenological existence, not necessarily the very highest, not enlightenment and spiritual bliss maybe, but certainly to, you know, feeling intensely alive, to feel, you know, great lightness and joy, to feel a light shining through being itself, right? And when frustrated or hurt, we fall into very low states. So into severe anxieties, into extreme loneliness, hell-like conditions and so on that we can feel trapped in. So, and high and low states are linked to adult development and to transformation. And because we fall in love with people who are instrumental to bringing pieces or elements that we want to develop into, that we want to transform into, it connects all layers of our being. So it connects, you know, we talk about the chakras, but you don't have to use that, this terminology, but it connects, of course, to the genitals and our animal self. It also connects to our higher ideals about what a good life is. It connects to our values. It connects to our dreams. It connects to our vision of utopia. And it connects to our selfhood, our at the center of all that, and our will. So it connects when we fall in love and we try to transform into something new by opening up, relating to a new human being. We try to shift in developmental stage a lot of the times, or at least transform. Doesn't have to be through developmental stages. But the point is here that they're kind of fulcrum points then. The times we fall in love in life are often fulcrum points between these stations through which we evolve. Or of course, they're just life phases, Ericksonian life phases. So you go to university. This is an example from Alberoni's own book. You go to university, want to become a part of that world. You're going to fall in love with somebody who represents that, for instance. So yeah, a lot is at stake here. It's a conveyor belt. Spirituality is a conveyor belt for our transformation and our development. And because the most common way of and certainly a very visceral way of connecting all the dots in our being and going to the higher states and trying to transform through those, when everything seems clear and we feel fall in love with life itself, when we're in touch with cosmic eroticism, then we can transform into a new kind of consciousness. And meaning that we thereafter view the world differently, a kind of religious experience, I guess. And this is, of course, many have observed that romantic love in our secular days has taken the place of religion in many ways. Yeah, that says something about how important it is to get this right, and also where all the super strong energies and bitterness and pathologies are coming from. Because what happens is, tantric risky, that the deeper we delve into this space of phenomenological experience, we talked about it the other time, subtle causal non-dual layers of experience, the deeper we also delve into our own psyche and more fundamental aspects of what it feels for us to be alive. So our attachment patterns are activated when we're in this wobbly new space of when we're changing stuff at, let's say, the causal layer of our phenomenological experience, as we discussed last time. So something that that feels fundamental to how reality itself is experienced we get in touch with that when we're in love with another person, and particularly if the relationship is successful in the tantric sense, that we really, really, truly, and deeply connect. So tantric sex, for instance, is dangerous for this reason, that you can open each other up learning a bunch of different techniques and so on, you can open each other up a lot, and then you attach very, very deeply, and you can spontaneously create a very, very, very strong connection. Now, if something isn't right in the circumstances, or you're not right for each other, etc., you're going to have just a hell of a lot of trouble to get over each other and get on with it. And you can't get that experience anywhere else. And you're left with chronic loneliness and hurt, which then impedes your development and your cosmic erotic relationship to life. Yeah, failure to integrate transpersonally. Once we open up these transpersonal spaces, I am you, you are me, I am inside, you are beyond, you are, you surround me, I melt away, I soar deeper into you, we soar together, and then things don't work out. Then you're in a bunch of trouble. And particularly if you're experimenting with polyamory at the same time, you go back to your other partner and you have these kinds of experiences to deal with, and you and your partner don't connect at that level. Well, that's also a bunch of trouble. Well, so basically we as humanity have a bunch of homework to do to master these farther reaches of cosmic eroticism and relationality. It's going to be painful. It's going to be tragic. It's risky, but hey, we have to try to figure it out together. So where does all of this discussion point us? I'd like to point towards a positive example, not end on a like sad note. I want to say that I put endpoints in plural, because what I present here is a kind of the transpersonal endpoint of transformational feminism, post-feminism, neo-masculist, tantric, romantic, religious, spiritual love in a heterosexual, straightforward heterosexual relationship. Now, I imagine that as we develop as a society and the experience and the full spectrum of gender opens up to us more, there go, and family formation complex opens up to a more complex set of family formations, there are going to be different schemas that represent different positive endpoints, or I wouldn't say endpoints, I'd say plateaus, like a higher plateau, a peak to reach, which stabilizes. But the one between men and women, and the heterosexual one, looks something like this, I would argue. You start out as equals. We accepted feminism, right? So we start out as boy and girlfriend. And you know, your partners getting to know each other, you have ups and downs, time goes by, the relationship, the fabric of the relationship gets richer, you find out about each other's strengths and weaknesses, you eventually accept the stuff that you wouldn't have normally. And in this dynamic, though, once you are in an intimate relationship, and if things go well in a way that is satisfying to both the man and the woman, usually the man will prove his worth as a partner. So this sexuality or sex is hard currency here, that the man proves his worth. I can give you this pleasure. And this pleasure can open you up to high states, for instance. But also I am competent. So and the woman, of course, the woman recognizes that eventually. And if things go well, if the develop, and here for this reason, the capacity building of masculism, the capacity of building strong men, capable men, in this emotional, relational sense is very important. But there is a feminine surrender when these pretenses break down, that you're no longer exactly equal, that the man does give a pleasure to the woman that the woman, that is beyond the pleasure that the woman gives to the man. And the man does show up in her life in a way that impresses her, and she admires the man. He drives her back as well. But there, but this, the classical masculine and feminine kind of starts to reassert itself. And it does so clearly when the woman admits that she admires him deeply and so on. But even good and strong men are clusterfucks, and they're going to fail sooner or later, and they're going to fail pretty bad. So sooner or later, you have the male failure. Now, the male failure can be sexual, it can be professional, it can be social, it can be emotional, it can be a breach of trust. It can be one of these many things, right? But sooner or later, the man does fail the woman, and she is disappointed at this man who had nevertheless won her trust and admiration. And this is then the watershed point. Either the relationship breaks down and they have to go separate ways, or we have to go separate ways. Or if the relationship has been successful enough to up to that point, there is the feminine acceptance of the male failure. So the man breaks down, cries like a baby, and becomes entirely helpless and admits how weak and vulnerable he is and how much he just needs mommy's love. And if he would have done that in the dating or courting period, well, it wouldn't have been attractive, and for good reason too. It just wouldn't have made any sense, you know? But there are moments when a man has no pretense of being strong. He's just a baby. He just cries and he just needs love as the failure he is. Given though that he has proven over a longer stretch of time that he's morally worthy and capable, chances are he will be accepted, unless this brings up some trauma in the woman and she rejects him. And that can be extremely, extremely, extremely painful for both. Now, the man and the woman are then not equals. The woman gets enormous power, like a god and a goddess, and the man becomes entirely subjected, like a baby and his mother. And the woman becomes not just a woman in his life, she becomes his goddess. However, if that watershed is successfully traversed, if the man feels so accepted, his weakest parts are accepted, then you have the masculine surge. You feel super, super, super strong. You feel like the shit because your weakest sides that you've hid away all your life, trying to be tough and try to be accepted and all of that, they were accepted. You feel grounded, you feel strong. And what happens is, hey, you get a whole lot of erotic and emotional energy and power, and you feel very grounded. And this is where it erupts like a volcano, really, as a surprise, the benevolent patriarchy. So here, and this is why masculism has to be reconstructed. We're reconstructing patriarchy, but we need to go to the bottom of our vulnerability to do it. And then of course, a lot of times sex gets more intimate, it gets more visceral, carnal, more dominant and submissive sometimes. And just the energies go through the roof. But here it is then that the man gets on top because he gets all of this new energy. And that's where there is a release of the holy slut. So the woman is released in when she's held by this stronger patriarchy, a stronger man, which is a patriarchy. Yes, it's a father figure, but it's not exactly like when the woman was on top, where she was a god and the other is a baby. It's more like a father figure or a king, and the other is a teenage girl or something. And she can live out the fact that she has been a sexual being all of her life and been trapped in a society where that's not entirely accepted. And she has always been held back in this regard. And because the man feels entirely accepted by the woman, he has enough extra emotional energy and power to accept the threat of that carnal sexuality, which is actually not very monogamous, for instance. Not saying that this has to bloom into polyamorous practices, but or anything like that. But you kind of wash slut shaming. You just kind of wash it out, and you have the holy slut, and then you have a lot more fun. But then we've then gone on a huge journey from like being boyfriend and girlfriend, which is fine. Like a lot of people can stay there. But then the schisms are always going to be there and the frictions are always going to be there to more stable, stronger double bond, not a double bind, but a double bond, where the woman sees the vulnerable little shit that her guy is, accepts that, and the man rises to the occasion and releases her inner holy slut. And holy because it's no longer dirty, it's sacred more, right? And that's, that's a good place. It's a stable and strong place for family formation, and it kind of combines the feminist ideals of equality. So there's a deep equality to this with polarity, but there's a dynamic polarity, a dialectical polarity, where these things shift back and forth. So I would say that's kind of a end point, but I recognize that there are a plateau of metamodern sexuality, gender, family formation complex. But I imagine that in this wider landscape that opens up, there are going to be more to be explored by brave explorers. I will stop sharing the screen and let you guys in. Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks, Daniel. A lot to think about there. So now we're going to move into a question and answer period. So if you have any questions, just drop them in the chat and I'll call on you. If you don't want to be on YouTube, then just let me know and I'll read the question for you. So with that, Rob Hart had a question before he left. Metamodernism's ability to dance between inherent and constructed realities seems like an essential gift to our current cultural moment. Modernism thought that sex and gender differences were givens, which ignores or takes for granted all social conditioning. Postmodernism has posited that all gender and sex differences are socially constructed, which prohibits any discussion of the consequences of biology and inherent differences. How does metamodernism mediate between these two extremes? And what emerges in the sexual game when we have that conversation at a metamodern level?
Well, I don't know how far Rob was part, but that's kind of what I've been trying to answer through the talk, I suppose. He wrote that, I suppose, a bit earlier on, right? But my reply would be, exactly this, that first of all, we need to be wary of the different slides away from a dialectical synthesis or proto-synthesis of the modern and the postmodern, the traditional, that we want, of course, to integrate the traditional and the modern and the postmodern in the metamodern, and then drawing even before the traditional, even going back to shamanic practices and stuff like that. What we want to be wary of are these transcend but not include or allergic reactions to the pathologies of different of the different movements. So the primary one, I suppose, in metamodern space is anti-feminism of different kinds. That yes, we can and should be wary of and skeptical towards the pathologies of feminism, which of course they can be issues of just not very good theorizing. For instance, the patriarchy theory is perhaps not the strongest theory in the world because it doesn't actually reflect the perspectives of the men, nor is it disprovable. Or that you overemphasize the social construction of gender at the expense of biology, these different things, right? We should be skeptical of those, but we shouldn't throw out the baby with the bathwater, and we shouldn't throw out either modern or postmodern feminism. We should include the striving for emancipation and equality of these. And if you fail to do so, what happens is you will have more culture wars and you will have more gender antagonism, that you just breed this vicious cycle. Because looking at women today, so maybe you grow up in a small town, then you move to a university city. In the small town, you never learned to question your gender or the gender regime that you live under. And hey, then you're in your 20s and you learn about, hey, there's all this feminist stuff there, you can question power structures, and you notice all of these straitjackets that you've been wearing, and you notice all this ball and chain that you're dragging around. You notice that you can't even walk down the street without being subtly threatened by sexual violence. You notice that you're valued for your looks. You notice that if you manage to be good looking for a while, then you're viewed in a very one-dimensional manner. So you get pissed off and you say, hey, society, you've been serving me Kool-Aid here. It's bullshit. And you're right to be pissed off about those things. You're a human being, not a Barbie doll, and all of that. So if that aspect is denied, when men will say, I'm not a feminist, I'm for equality, for instance, they're failing to take that perspective. And in failing to take that perspective, what it sounds like to the feminist enlightened woman, the postmodern feminist enlightened woman, is that you want to take away the only weapon that I have to defend myself against all that bullshit that oppressed me for my whole life. I'm not going to have that. Basically transcend and include, but to be able to transcend and include, you need to discern. And then what you need to discern is particularly see what is productive and true in each of the critiques or each of these stages. And at the same time, add something. And the correct response to postmodern feminism is, okay, please describe what experience is like for a guy. And they're going to be completely off. They're like, oh, you feel super powerful. You enjoy your privileges. That's not at all what we feel like. They're getting it all wrong, which is why we all ended up reading Neil Strauss, The Game, instead of feminist theory, because that reflected our experience of being sexually frustrated, of not figuring out what women want, of feeling double bound by on the one hand, I'm supposed to be feminist and nice. On the other hand, nice guys finish last and bad boys are incredibly attractive, not least in the popular media and stuff. And so it's a confusing landscape, but I believe that just clarity in this developmental landscape kind of automatically guides you towards these conclusions, towards a neo-masculist post-feminist conclusion. I guess I just repeated myself, but I hope that brings some clarity to it.
Awesome, thanks for that. Joshua Myers wanted to hear if you had more to say about alternative family formations. Is that something you could speak to?
So not a lot. It's just that what we imagine today as the family is going to be something different tomorrow. It has always been in flux and change. But likely, just as I proposed a powerful attractor point, which is an ideal, I suppose, and I'm not saying, oh, well, this is how it's going to happen now in everyone's life. I'm just saying that these are the potentials that we're opening up towards when we're going deeper in spirituality, more experimental in our relationships, reconstructing patriarchy and so on. Benevolent patriarchy, which a very key aspect of benevolent patriarchy is that it's very, very, very good at listening, so that when it asserts masculinity, its assertion of masculinity already includes a recognition of femininity, of course, and a recognition of the personhood of the other person. So that's one attractor point. What I imagine is we will have a set, or like I wouldn't say a smorgasbord because it sounds just like a mix, right? But I imagine a set of a few different likely or corresponding set points, some of which may be more difficult to achieve than others, but just to mention a few that are likely. A renewed traditional family along the lines of what I said, which isn't necessarily for people's whole lives. People can perhaps also switch between these family formations over a life course a bit more often, but the switches are likely to be tumultuous and painful, of course. You also have a polyamorous set. Like if you look at the particular developmental pathway I suggested, then in that one, once you have released the holy slut, maybe jealousy and envy can subdue, and you can actually open up for more polyamorous practices. I'm not sure. I'm not a sex guru, so don't listen to me on these things. A third one, of course, has to do with homosexual families of different kinds. And then a fourth one has to do with collective families, families living in collectives and recreated larger communities. So the very, very strong energies that I suggested in the first one may not, maybe they're better in a solitary pair or a solitary couple than in a house with many adults, for instance, because there's enough space and room for all of these dynamics to play out, which can be confusing to other people, I suppose, to be part of even peripherally. And then star families of different kinds, meaning stuff like, well, you have an ex-wife, but you also have a wife, and then you have to figure out the things with the kids from different families, and that we get related in a somewhat more complex manner because we shift partners a little bit more often on average. Likely, we need to discover the deep inherent attractor points or set points within as much as five different kinds of families. I didn't even get into intersexuality. And within heterosexual families, you have, I suppose, somewhat different dynamics as well, depending on whether or not you have a very hyper-masculine, hyper-feminine woman or less so. So the dynamics are going to look somewhat differently. Where we're at right now is that people are having a very unproductive argument about which one of these is the future family. They say that the couple, for instance, is tied to bourgeois capitalist society on the left and stuff like that. And then people say we have to defend the family against all these liberal potheads who just want to have sex with everyone and irresponsibly. And I mean, there's some truth to both those sides. But what we really want is a conscientious exploration of the whole field of new family formations, and that these should become norms and institutions. Because right now, when people try out, for instance, polyamory, the institutions are so weak and the norms so weak that these places are just filled to the brim with exploitation. What I don't believe is a future family, for many reasons, is full on emancipated sexuality. Everybody sleeps with everybody, because it's just too unsustainable and too prone to sexual abuses. So particularly if we look at tantric sexuality in these days, we have there's a clear lineage, even you could say, that the new tantra was revealed as a organization with quite nasty cult-like aspects, and people have witnessed, and people have quit and provided reports that are horrifying about what went on there and how people were sexually abused in the name of liberalizing or emancipating themselves from sexual conditioning, as it was called. Now, the new tantra is directly derived also from David Deida's stuff. The Alexander or no, Vartman something, who started that, drew directly on David Deida's stuff. David Deida's stuff is very inspiring and very good, but But David Data stuff in turn, of course, comes with this heavy, like, well, playing on very strong psychological forces on this, well, heavy baggage from directly from Adidas spiritual community. And Adidas spiritual community also had sexual abuses in it. In the first Hanzi book, we write something about the guru fucking your wife. And this, we particularly imply what went on there. And this has, of course, imbued the integral community as well. And people who have read Ken Wilber and stuff. And I once listened to a clip with Adida, and I noticed that people were moaning in exclamation or in agreement with what he was saying. So he was saying something wise, I suppose. And you hear women in this kind of soft, broken moan saying something like, yes, yes, or something like that, and in the choir when he says something. But some years went by, and I was watching a documentary on the Jonestown sect, and they actually played the clip from when Jim Jones was in Guyana, and he was making his "Let's all commit revolutionary suicide" speech, and they were going to drink this poison Kool-Aid with cyanide. And I heard the same moan. People were saying, yes, in the exact same manner. So yes, we want to break up the family and reinvent it and re-explore it, but then find stable family formations with norms and institutions that work and function, and where there's like a folk wisdom or experience, shared experience around what works and doesn't. And today we don't have that for most of these new family formations, but we're going to find it together. Blogging is very important, I suppose, here, because people share experiences and stuff, but we're not going towards a dissolution of the family and into a free-for-all sexual union with each other. We're going to still form families, right, in a fairly conventional manner, most of us, most of the time, and the other experiments are likely for the foreseeable future to be highly unstable and likely very destructive and abusive.
All right. Peter's got a question. Peter, you want to ask it?
All right. I was in and out of this session, so you might have already touched on it, but so the question is, I had experience with the pickup artist scene, and their methods worked, for lack of better terms, and I took away from it a lot of virtues, values, courage, not fearing rejection, social skills to understand women's sexual needs better, etc. A lot of people who do get into the scene do turn into sociopaths, and turn women to what the philosopher Horvat calls fuck bodies, and they're like, seeing women's sexual nature in such a clinical way kind of disabuses the Madonna whore complex, which in turn a lot of men to the manosphere, the MGTOW, the incels, which all found their origins with kind of the insights of the pickup artist scene. So given all this, do you think anything from the pickup artist scene, the techniques, can be repurposed to encourage, to hold space for the holy sluts to emerge?
Yes, yes. I mean, you already said it, so I can't really say it better, but that was very succinct. But exactly, we said, even the word game in the beginning, right? So love is a tragedy because we have sexual desires. We're always making a claim. That claim can be rejected, and we're at least partly in competition and so on. And that locks us in not a zero, non-zero game, but at least a non-non-zero game, right? We want to develop the games of love and the games of romantic attachment and sexuality. And that can be done in many ways. We can change norms, we can change understandings of each other and perspective taking. We can become softer, more sensitive in our interactions. But we cannot remove the element of seduction, which includes an element of displays of attractiveness, of power, of agency and competence, and so on. So the issue is that today people are either or here. They're either game acceptors and they say, it's a game, we should learn to play it. Let's be cynical about it if we have to. And the other side says, let's be idealistic and deny that game. And I don't like that. Well, it still exists and the techniques do work. And these crude looks at the psychology of seduction are largely correct, right? Of course, they can be critiqued just like feminist theory can, but I'd actually like to put feminist theory and Neil Strauss, The Game, and all the other things that came out of that movement side by side and make them friends. Because the realization is that if we are to emancipate women, we need competent men. And men don't walk around feeling super strong and privileged. We feel helpless and clumsy. And if we feel nimble and competent instead, then we can be much, much, much better at being generous and gracious and so on, and not frustrated and not driven by frustration and bitterness. And at the same time, you can just avoid a bunch of misunderstandings that come from failed attempts at seduction. So this seduction attempts can become much more competent and sensitive. So by and large, if we want to change the games, we have to admit that they're there, and then we have to actually spread the knowledge about them so that they become second nature. Today, it's like this esoteric thing you have to read about in out on the web or in books, and it's like this big dirty secret. Rather, we should put these two things together, and we should say, these are the games, let's teach them, let's remove the misogynist elements of them, let's imbue them with good values, that values of equality, values of respect, values of seeing the whole human being and the multidimensional human beings. Of course, you want to be seen as a sexual object. You just don't want to be seen as only a sexual object. You want to be seen as a host of interesting qualities that you might have. If we remove gaming entirely from this equation, the feminist ideals are never going to become real, because we're removing the experience of men, which is that women are difficult to make contact with and sexually seduce and so on, unless you happen to land on a rock star position or something like that. And even when you do, you might have a life of frustrations behind you, so you actually misuse the newly gained power that you have, seductive power. And we see presidents doing this, for crying out loud. Bill Gates did it. So if Bill Gates had been more competent with women throughout his life, he might not have become the person who has to go use the fact that he's president to pick up a 21-year-old. And we would have had a more gender equal society, and woman respecting society and men respecting society for that matter.
I got a quick follow up on that. So my experience, and a lot of other men who experience that stuff too, is like learning the language of the sexual marketplace, especially for men, is really a game changer. It builds confidence. You become more sort of, cultivate better relationships. But one of the dark truths there is sort of the Pareto principle, the 80-20 principle in sort of a kind of a sexual marketplace that is not shamed to monogamy. is that, you know, it's like the women want to be with the alpha male, and then the alpha male is having sex with a lot of women. And I'm using the alpha male generally here. And even if you know good game, quote unquote, that kind of 80-20 thing still occurs, which creates a lot of men that become angry, aka the incels. Any thoughts on that?
Right. So first of all, when we mention three kinds of masculism, the first kind we mentioned was reactionary, right? That wants to do away with feminism, even perhaps with the bourgeois feminism, and really, well, more or less go back to, I don't know, traditional India or wherever, where you just were just kind of guaranteed a wife. That large host of angry men, or it's not just angry men, it's more spread out than that. It's not like this guy is angry and this isn't, but it's on a collective transpersonal level that there's this resentment and this gender antagonism that wants to, it feeds that particular kind of masculinism that should be recognized. Now, a couple of things. First of all, gender theory should have, if it is emancipatory, it should have solidarity with all parties. So first of all, the gender theory that seeks to create equal and fair relationships between men and women, it can and should correctly describe the suffering of all of those men and all of the sexual frustrations and emotional confusion and frustration, rejection, and confusion that are the experience of almost the majority of men, at least for periods of our lives. That needs to be included, of course, but that being said, the issue is still game change. That, okay, so the 80-20 rule is there, but it's not entirely immutable. Obviously, if more men learn more pickup, but fair and transparent pickup, if more men are more sexually capable, if society is more equal in other regards, financial regards, status regards, if women feel more secure, it's also been shown, for instance, that in more financially unequal and traditional societies, women go for more alpha male types and more for rich guys, whereas in fairly feminist and equal societies like Sweden, their taste in men changes, and the beta guys and the hipsters have a much, much, much easier time. And that's just one way to broaden the landscapes of desire, right? Also, the more people are allowed to experiment across the scale of gender roles and roles in society at large, and get second chances and third chances to do so, the broader and richer taste they also develop, so that perhaps the ideals themselves become more dimensional. We're never going to do away with, of course, we prefer beautiful to less beautiful, and we tend to want to avoid what we see as ugly. We prefer powerful to less powerful. We prefer competent to less competent, and so on. But the richer the culture, and the more transparent the power structures of the culture and the games and the norms around those, the more dimensions there are to play with. So the crux is, we can never, without going back to something horrific, you know, like pre-modern non-feminism, we can never dish out or, you know, redistribute these as goods. we can't redistribute the love and admiration of women as goods nor of men, right? Nor can we redistribute friendships or community, but we can create better and better generative conditions for these complex emergences to arrive in people's lives as a result of their own agency and powers, right? So basically we should empower the whole spectrum and create sympathy and solidarity for the rejections and failures. Today, we also don't have rituals for sexual rejection and failure. So if I'm a successful mating guy, let's say I found a beautiful woman and we like each other a lot, but then she breaks up with me, she finds another better guy. Then I can call all my friends and say, hey, aren't you feeling sorry for me? My girlfriend broke up with me. And there'll be a ritual that my buddies will take me out for a beer. Now, if I'm unsuccessful with women, and this was the 10th in the row that I fell in love with, and it didn't work out either, and she rejected me, she didn't want me, I can't call my friends and have a round. And even though my experience in life has been much more painful, so again, nobody cares today about the ugly women and the nerdy guys. We need a solidarity that stretches to those groups and empowers those groups because, hey, sexuality is ubiquitous. It is inherently tragic. You didn't ask. You were born into this world with a sexual drive, and now you're being rejected, and the claims you're making are not being accepted or met, then you're suffering for it. So we should have a gender theory that goes all the way to the rejected ones and has solidarity with that, and with these groups, and also understanding that sympathy is never enough. Empowerment is always the way forward. And then people are more likely to find productive outlets in their lives, right? Or at least not feel so bitter about it if they feel they get a lot more fair chances, they feel more understood, they don't feel invisible, and so on. So yeah, along those lines, empowerment through knowledge, empowerment through transparency, right? But people don't get the landscape. They don't see the game they're playing. So they just feel crushed by unfair rules, right? And then they make up false or poor theories about what's going on, driven by bitterness. And that feeds a vicious cycle, as I mentioned.
That's really good. Thanks, man.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks. All right. So we'll have to wrap it up now, but this was an awesome session. We really appreciate it. And there's going to be one more session with Daniel Görtz later, 1 week from today, same time. That will be a deep dive on metamodern faith, I believe. Is that correct?
And religion, yes.
All right. So next up, in a few short minutes, we have William McCaskill coming in with Effective Altruism, a philosophy and social movement that advocates using evidence and reasoning to determine the most effective ways to benefit others. So that's coming up. I'll drop, Peter dropped a link in chat. So if you want to join us for that, just RSVP and we'll see you there. So thanks, everybody. See you next week. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys.
She got to get whatever she don't got. Fellas droop like fools, but then again, they're only human. The chick was a hit because her body was booming. Gold, pearl, rubies, crazy diamonds. Nothing she wore was ever common. Her dates, heads of state, men of taste, lawyers.
So I just hit stop on the recording.
Oh, yeah, if you can. I took closed access from you.